here. So today I'm going to talk about my recent work with Professor Lin. So in this work, we studied the application of integral geometry in the ADS CFT. So we think these mathematical tools help us understand the connection between the geometry and tangent. So we show you the basic framework. So what we did was within the context of ADS CFT, we were restricted to the parameter space where we have a classical geometry in the block. And this geometry should emerge from the field theory, because we know the boundary is flat. And we believe the correct correspondent for this geometry is the entanglement. So one hint we have is this RT formula. We compute the entanglement entropy of some subregion A with its complement using the minimum surface gamma ending on the entangling surface sigma. So this gives us a connection between the entanglement and the geometry. So we think this integral geometry facilitates the study of this connection. So this work was initiated by a Czech and collaborators. And before that, many people has worked on related subjects like the differential entropy. Let's go directly to the integral geometry. So the main formula we are going to use is this so-called Coefficients formula. It says that the area or length of some geometric object can be expressed in the form of an integral over some reference object. So let's take a look at the simplest example of an ADS 3, or to be precise, a static slice on the ADS 3. So now it says the length of some generic curve, this gamma, is given by an integral over the geodesic, this big gamma, that hits this little gamma. And this n is the intersection number, so you can hit it once or multiple times. And of course, in order to do this integral, we need some measure, or the number density for these geodesics. And so let's go to the space of all this geodesic. This is so-called a kinematic space. So every point in this space represents a single geodesic in the original real space. So this space has its own geometry. You need to parameterize, give some coordinate of this space. Usually we can use the endpoint coordinates, but for convenience, we can also use the midpoint, and the separation between the two endpoints. And this space has a long geometry, and the metric, and more importantly, the measure or the volume element is given by the second derivative of the length of geodesic. So you can immediately see that this expression has an entropic interpretation because of the length of the geodesic is the entropy according to the RT formula. So in this quantity can be computed from the boundary. So the boundary entanglement entropy can determine the geometry in the kinematic space. But then we still need to go back to the real space to reconstruct the geometry in the real space. So to do this, we first construct a basic building block in the real space, which are the points. So every point in the real space becomes a curve in the kinematic space. This is over a point curve. Here are two examples. These two are the two points different in z coordinate in the real space. These are the two different in x coordinate. And they become a one-dimensional curve in this kinematic space. They consist of all the geodesics that pass through this real this point in the real space, so they become a one-dimensional curve. And to get the distance of these two of any two points that give us the information of a metric in the real space, we need to do the following integral, integrate over the region between the two point curves. Or to be precise, we integrate over this this region. This P A P B denotes the two point curves, and the theta is the future domain of dependence. Then we, from this integral, we get the distance. Okay, so let's move on to what we actually did. So first of all, we generalized the dimensions. So here is the formula, the Crofton's formula in higher dimension. Again, this L is the reference object. For our purpose, we only consider this LR to be a geodesic unit. The R is the dimension, so R is equal to 1. And Q is the Q-dimensional object we want to study. And if we take LR to be, this LR to be geodesic, this MQ is restricted to be a D minus 1 dimension object in the D dimensional real space. So these O's on the right hand side are the area of unit sphere, so they are just some number. So the Crofton's formula in higher dimension tells us that the area of this object D minus 1 dimensional surface is given by the flux. Now this sigma is generically it is the cross the area of the cross section of these two objects. But now when this LR is the one dimensional geodesic, this is again the intersection number. So it's, it gives the area is given by the flux of the geodesic. And then to do the integral, we need this measure. And the mathematician has found that the correct way to find the measure is to use some invariant form in the phase space of the geodesic. And in this particular case, the Crofton formula, they prove this Crofton formula is valid. So this is only true and well understood in the case when this is the geodesic. So if we can use some other reference object, the situation is less well studied. But in the case of we can use this invariant form to define the measure, and with some algebra we can rewrite this measure again as the second derivative of the length of the geodesic. So this x1 x2 are two endpoints, and we do the two derivative and get the measure. Of course now the endpoints have many components, so we'll get a determinant instead. Now in higher dimension, the s is the length of geodesic, but is no longer related to the entanglement unit. But still, this quantity can be computed from the two-point correlator of Harry operators on the boundary. So it remains a quantity that can be obtained from the field theory, right? So we can still get a geometry in the kinematic space of geodesics. So as before, we can try to reproduce the geometry in the real space. We'll work in this symmetric space of a homogeneity isotropy. And the Crofton formula can only tell us the area of the D minus 1 dimensional object, so it's some surface, no longer the light element. So we need to use some trick to consider a little strip along the direction of the light element, and we can use Crofton formula to reproduce the area of this strip, and then rip off the line element from this expression, and we check, we can find the right line element. And the other thing we can do is to reproduce the RT formula. And in this case, we are also working in a highly symmetric space of QADS, and we consider the entangling surface of a circle, because otherwise we don't know we don't have a closed form of the entanglement of it. And in this case, to get the entanglement entropy of this object, we can just integrate over all the geodesic with n points separated by the entanglement surface. And then we get the result of a divergent integral. So this is what we expected. The point is that this expression has the right divergent structure, and more importantly, it has right universal term as predicted by the RT formula. So now let's try to kind of understand the meaning of that volume element, that epsilon k. So we propose that this can be understood as the entanglement contour, and it gives us the measure of the two-point entanglement. So every point in this kinematic space is parametrized by two n points. So we think the volume element at that point gives us a measure of the entanglement between these two n points. So entanglement contour was introduced as the contribution of some subsystem I of this A to the total entanglement entropy A. So we just divide this total entanglement entropy SA as many additive parts, and each of them is the contour. So of course, in our case, the A is just a pod. We consider the entanglement contour of a pod, or rather infinitesimally small spatial region, and we use the A bar as the label of all the additive parts. And this definition is motivated by the entanglement entropy of this pod. And from the constant formula, we know the area of this infinitesimal small region is given by all the geodesic, the total number of geodesic ending on this pod. And then the number density is positive definite, and we can understand as the contour. So how we get to this definition. So with this definition, we can try to study the renormalization flow of this contour. So entanglement is a property of the state. So if it's renormalized, that means it's changed, the state is changed under the RG. So here we have a nice setup to see how this is done. This is called the multi-scale entanglement normalization SS. This was originally introduced to compute the ground state wave function of many body systems. Here is a cartoon to see how it's done. So we start from a one-dimensional lattice, and then each step of RG, we perform some local unitary transformation, some matrix acting on this lattice sides. So these blue blocks are so this entangler, you remove the entanglement between neighboring sides, and they will perform the cross-graining to reduce the size of the human state in half. The size of the lattice in half, and the number of lattice in half. And we repeat this process, eventually we get to a state with only a few sides, and there's no entanglement, and this IR state, the wave function of this IR state can be obtained easily, and then we can multiply this IR state back to get the original UV state, and all this precise form of this local unitary matrix can be determined from a variation principle. And Brian Schwinger noticed that this mirror lattice has a very similar structure as the ADS holography. The key observation is the realization of RT formula in this mirror lattice. So at each step of RG, some of the entanglement of a certain subregion is reduced by both types of operation. For example, the disentangler, this horizontal link, it removes the entanglement entropy. And so does the isometry, which transfers some of the entanglement from the side to some side outside the region. So both of them reducing the entanglement entropy. Eventually, we get to the zero entanglement entropy. So the total entanglement entropy of a certain region is bounded by this total number of operation or the number of links cut on this lattice. So this is very similar to the RT formula. That's why they have this mirror ADS correspondence. But the mirror lattice itself is discrete. So to actually go to a continuum limit, we need to add back some degree of freedom on each layer. So each layer, we have the same degree of freedom, and this layer become a surface in the ADS space. It corresponds to a different state in the same cubic space. So this is sort of the surface state correspondence. This may be a bit trivial, but the point is that we can apply ADS safety to each of these excited state. For example, for a certain excited state, we can use the geodesic ending on this new surface to compute its entanglement entropy. So in this setup, we can consider the renormalization of entanglement contour. So this entanglement contour has a very nice property that it can be defined on different surface or slices. So recall that it is defined as the second derivative of the length of a geodesic. The geodesic has to end somewhere. Previously, we just think of this geodesic to end on the UV boundary. But in fact, we can choose a different boundary and then let the geodesic adding on the new surface that actually change the length of the geodesic. And we can choose the coordinates on this new surface to do the second derivative. And mathematician have proved that, it's very easy to show that. The same expression gives the correct measure in the kinematic space. So that means we can define this entanglement control of all these different sizes and can study the algae behavior of the control. And the behavior is in fact very simple. As we can see from this graph, we go from the surface Z to Z plus DZ. There's a one step of algae flow. The short range entanglement represented by this smaller circle no longer appear on the next slide. That means the short range entanglement is removed by this algae process. This is precisely what the mirror predicts. This operation is performed by this entangler on the mirror lattice. And the long range entanglement, which is represented by this vector circle, remain on the next slide. But the endpoints change. The separation between these two endpoints shrinks. It says that this long range entanglement remains, but the entanglement is reshuffled to shorter scale. The corresponding operation on the mirror lattice is the so-called isomergy, the coarse grain and little red triangle shown on the previous slides. So this is the normalization of the entanglement control. It's consistent with what is predicted by the mirror. So let me summarize. So the punchline of this talk is that we have this duality between the real space and this kinematic space. And the geometry of one can determine the other. And it's easier to reconstruct the geometry of this kinematic space because they are just some object like geodesic or high dimension, maybe some human surface. And the number of density of this geodesic can be understood as the entanglement control, and it gives us a measurement of the two-point entanglement. And also we can study this the renormalization of this entanglement, because you can define on all these different surfaces. Finally, there are some virtual problems, but I don't have too much to say about this because we are all preliminary stages. So let me just stop here. Okay, for your attention.